You guys ever like get halfway through a video and realize that your camera is not recording? Well, that happens to me sometimes, but then I soldier on. So I wanted to go back in time to May 23rd of 2017, which was the first active day of the affectionately titled Evergreen Spring. Now, what kicked the ball off? Well, there's other things that happened before this, but the first protest of that week was, of course, of Brett Weinstein. Then, after the protest, some cops arrived. We'll get into all the details. Anyhow, I just wanted to bring up that the first thing I heard about all the trouble at Evergreen was that I was laying on my bed. Now, I was an Evergreen student. I don't know if you knew that or not. I was about to graduate. I'd been, like, soldiering my way through my final project slash magnum opus, but that will have to be decided posthumously. Anyway, so I was laying in bed, and I woke up, and I was, like, looking at my Facebook. Now, I don't really look at Facebook anymore, but I was looking through that, and I noticed that over and over and over again, there was the same post being posted by my Evergreen contacts. I'm like, what's going on? And it was, like, urgent message for immediate release, and that was all in caps. And I don't know about you, but when somebody writes something all in caps, I totally pay attention to every single thing that they're saying. Not really, but this time I did read it. But I have video of one of the authors of this news release reading the actual press release, and I'm gonna let them read it aloud. And they're reading it on May 23rd on the fourth floor of the library building at that 4 o'clock meeting, which a lot of things happened at. But here you go.
So, for everybody who's not involved with everything that's gone down this morning, we have a press release that we wrote, and I'll be reading it. It's a little long, so bear with me. At approximately 9:30 in the morning, a group of about 50 students were organizing a peaceful protest against anti-black remarks that a faculty member, Brett Weinstein, had made in past emails. Weinstein came out of the D building after receiving reports of the students' plans, attempting to block the students from entering the building. He then decided to let the students in the building, where they made their way throughout the building. Students read from a statement.
We come here as students against campus racism and against anti-blackness on campus, and we would like to reach out to the students of color, the humanities, as well as the sciences that we are here to support,
and we want to dismantle anti-blackness and confine. We want to give some sense of solidarity and provide safety and outside.
That's the statement we made. And we asked Weinstein to take responsibility for his actions and the statements that he made in his anti-black emails.
All right. So this is one thing I haven't read. Of all the things that I've read at Evergreen, all the emails and all the notices and all the posters, I have never read this email chain aloud. So this should be a great treat for all of us. I'm going to read three emails, one from Brett Weinstein, and then a reply from Genevieve Garlineau, who is not to be confused with the statistical geneticist who lives and works in New York on the human genome. One, because obviously the content of this email would not be written by a statistical geneticist, I'm pretty sure. And secondly, this is a staff member at Evergreen State College. And then I'm going to read the reply email to Genevieve's reply to Brett's email. But let's go to that first email. Written by Brett Weinstein, sent on March 15th, 2 months and 1 week before the protests, 2017, and delivered at 2:50 p.m. to Rashida Love and the all staff and faculty, DL. Subject, regarding invitation and schedules for day of absence / day of presence, 2017. Dear Rashida, when you first described the new structure for day of absence / day of presence at a past faculty meeting where no room was left for questions, I thought I must have misunderstood what you said. Later emails seemed to muddy the waters further while inviting commitments to participate. As a footnote, during the Equity Council regular meeting held on Wednesday, January 11th, 2017, Felix Braffeth reported that Rashida Love has secured commitments from 15 to 17 faculty members to require that their students participate in Day of Absence, Day of Presence, which brings the total to 400 students. The goal is to have 1,000 students participating in this event. Emily Piper subsequently reported that there is a proposal from the Day of Absence, Day of Presence Committee for white students to go off campus and students of color to remain on campus. This has been approved. This is to center the campus on students of color. I now see from the bold-faced text in this email that I had indeed understood your words correctly. I'm going to read what I believe are the bolded words in question, either of two choices. One, which is really large font, please notice that in 2017, for the first time, we are reversing the pattern of previous years. Our Day of Absence program is specially designed for faculty, staff, and students of color, will happen on campus this year, while our concurrent program for allies will take place off campus. And then there's this other little bolded thing. The theme of this year is, revolution is not a one-time event. Your silence will not protect you. Which I just love that. I love that they use that. It's beautiful. It's so prophetic and not incriminating at all about the tenor and tone of this Day of Absence stuff. Anyhow, to return to Brett's email. There is a huge difference between a group or coalition deciding to voluntarily absent themselves from a shared space in order to highlight their vital and underappreciated roles, the theme of the Douglas Turner Ward play Day of Absence, as well as the recent Women's Day walkout, and a group or coalition encouraging another group to go away. The first is a forceful call to consciousness, which is, of course, crippling to the logic of oppression. The second is a show of force and an act of oppression in and of itself. You may take this letter as a formal protest of this year's structure, and you may assume I will be on campus on the Day of Absence. Such pluck from Weinstein's Quarter. I would encourage others to put phenotype aside and reject this new formulation, whether they have registered for it already or not. On a college campus, one's right to speak or to be must never be based on skin color. Is that anti-blackness? I mean, what is the mindset that would construe these words as anti-black? To continue, if there was interest in a public presentation and discussion of race through a scientific/evolutionary lens, I would be quite willing to organize such an event. It is material I have taught in my own programs and guest lectured on at Evergreen and elsewhere. Everyone would be equally welcome and encouraged to attend such a forum, irrespective of ethnicity, belief structure, native language, political leanings, or position at the college. My own requirement would be that people attend with an open mind, is that anti-blackness, being open-minded, and a willingness to act in good faith. Now, is that anti-blackness? I think I'm walking a line, so I'll hold back on that. Pardon me if that came off wrong. If there is an interest in such an event, please let me know at Brett Weinstein's email, actually his Gmail. That's how much he believes in this. So, on March 16, 2017, at 1:58 p.m., about 24 hours later, Genevieve Garlineau, staff member of Evergreen State College, replies, Brett, I wonder at your call for a scientific or evolutionary discussion of race. Perceptions of race differ cross-culturally, making it less of a scientific classification as it is social. The social distinction of race, as well, is less concerned with phenotypes as it is with, get this, positionality and power differentials. Furthermore, we must acknowledge that a scientific discussion, why, just, if you hate science, just call it science. why use this? If you're just going to throw out the baby and the bathwater, you don't need to do this, because you're not protecting anything. You want science to go away. Shoo, STEM, shoo. Furthermore, we must acknowledge that a scientific discussion of race is also heavily informed by our socialization. The academic discourses of the evolutionary sciences and ethnography alike have their early roots in racially prejudiced theories, which reinforce white supremacy. One such example being cultural evolutionary theory, which posits that cultures evolve in a linear sequence and firmly stakes European accomplishments as the pinnacle of human achievements and consequentially the benchmark by which to judge everyone else. Now, I want to say a couple things there. One, first and foremost, this way of thinking has its roots in European accomplishments and thinking. This whole critique is founded in critical theory, Frankfurt School, yada, 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 French intellectualism, etc., right? So this is one of the crowning achievements, is to diss the crowning achievements of Western civilization, and she's not being self-reflexive enough about that, which is disappointing. Also, this constant refrain that science is wrong because at some point somebody had the wrong idea is completely just, that's not what science is. Science is having a postulate and then constantly looking for ways to disprove yourself, right? So of course, bad ideas are going to be left behind. And if she wanted to actually listen to Brett's talk, I'm sure she would learn a thing or two about what he means by looking at racism or race through a scientific lens. To continue with her email, personally, I think the role reversal of this year's DOA is brilliant, in that it encourages Evergreen's white population to take accountability for their active participation in unlearning racial prejudice in a way that staying on campus wouldn't. Like Pauline Yu mentioned at yesterday's faculty meeting, yes, talking about race is hard, but that doesn't mean we should set it aside for later. We have all had to work hard in order to earn our degrees and be here, so it clearly not beyond our intellectual capabilities. Let me read that again, just for the irony quotient. So it clearly not beyond our intellectual capabilities. In fact, those of us in higher education have an obligation as educators to put in that hard work for the betterment of our community at and beyond Evergreen. Now, ironically, she's saying that she doesn't want to hear what Brett has to say about race. And then she says, talking about race is so hard. But that doesn't mean we should set it aside for later. Brett wasn't saying that they should set it aside. He was wanting to participate. In short, bullet point one, race, while having phenotypical markers, is primarily a social construction that sustains itself through power differentials. Which is ironic because if you believe in that, then the way to reverse that is to take over the institution, is to violently overthrow your oppressors. If everything is based on power differentials, well, the only way to solve that is through a backlash of power. So, leads right to the protest. Bullet point two, a scientific or evolutionary discussion of race does not exist in a vacuum and cannot be separated from issues of power and, get this, positionality. So she's saying that, which might be true, that this conversation doesn't happen in a vacuum, but how does that underscore the fact that she doesn't want to hear what Brett has to say? So maybe this whole critical theory, positionality, power differential stuff, maybe that doesn't happen in a vacuum either. Maybe that is informed, one might want to know this, by biology and other evolutionary forces, perhaps Putetra. Bullet point three, DOA role reversal empowers the white population at Evergreen by telling them to leave, to engage in deliberate talks about race and allyship in which our colleagues of color have participated in past years. That might be a good point. I still think it's coercive, personally. Bullet point four, at last, the... At last? Bullet point four, at last. The DOA role reversal highlights the fact that racism is not a person of color issue, but a human issue that everyone needs to work on consistently. And that's why we should have people segregate based on race. Does that make sense? We should act racially because we're all implicit in racism. Best, Genevieve Garlineau. Brett Weinstein replies on Saturday, March 18th, about 24 hours later. These guys are like clockwork. Hi, Jen. I appreciate that you are able to be publicly critical of my position while remaining constructive and treating me like a human being. It is a model of how dialogue should be at Evergreen. I agree with your thesis about the historical misuse of science as it has so often been applied to the concept of race. But I think it is also important to point out an irony in your desire to raise my awareness of this pattern. Many will recognize Weinstein as a German Jewish name. My ancestors were all European Jews, primarily from Russia, Poland, and Ukraine. European Jews, like my ancestors, have faced repeated waves of anti-Semitic persecution stretching back at least as far as the 3rd century BCE. The most recent wave was at its height a mere 25 years before my birth. The Nazis were then at the peak of their final solution to the Jewish question. Their solution began simply with registration, bullying, and sanctioned violence. It moved on to walled ghettos in which Jews died by the thousands from starvation and murder at the hands of Nazi police. Outside the ghettos, mass shootings were arranged across Europe. 33,771 Jews were robbed of every possession, stripped naked, and machine-gunned over the course of just 2 days at Babi Yar, for example. But this method proved too psychologically taxing for the executioners, and the accumulation of bodies was impractical. As a result, the Nazis devised labor and death camps to sanitize and streamline their genocide. Those who are sensitive may wish to skip the next paragraph. I'm sorry, I'm going to be fair. Brett dropped a 2. May wish skip the next paragraph. Not only were the Jews of Europe methodically exterminated, but many were enslaved and worked to death in service to their tormentors. The most unlucky among them, the Sonderkommandos, were chosen on arrival at a camp, isolated from all other slaves, and forced to do the dirty work of hauling never-ending streams of freshly murdered people from the gas chambers, prying the gold from their teeth before incinerating the bodies in the crematoria. It was not uncommon for them to encounter the corpses of friends and relatives in the course of their work. It was traditional for the Nazi guards to initiate new Sonderkommandos by having them process the bodies of the Sonderkommandos they were chosen to replace. I raise this sickening history because the Nazi high command explicitly rationalized their depraved, deliberately cruel extermination, Jews, homosexuals, Jehovah's Witnesses, and Roma, with an overt appeal to Darwinism. As a Jewish evolutionary biologist, I do not think I could possibly be any more aware of the hazard posed by weaponized Darwinian logic. When I offered to provide an evolutionary perspective on race, it was not to justify oppression, as many seem to have imagined. It was, quite to the contrary, with an eye toward permanently ending oppression by understanding and addressing it at its evolutionary root. I truly believe that scientific enlightenment of this sort could ensure that genocide never happens again to anyone. Thanks again for the humanity evident in your approach. Signed, Brett. So, those are 3 emails, 2 of which were written by Brett, 2 of which might be proof that he is anti-black. What? I don't see that. Most other people don't see it. But let's continue with the press release.
Students were understandably upset, but were not overtly threatening him in any harmful way. Brett Weinstein began filming the students once they entered the building, but was contesting their rights to film him. The students then peppered Weinstein with questions, asking if he knew that what he did was harmful to both students and the faculty of color.
Will you listen to me?
Yeah.
Okay. No, not maybe, please.
No, if you decide to
stop. Go! Go!
I'm committed to equity. I'm as committed, I believe, as anyone on this campus. I happen to disagree with other folks on this campus about the way there. Okay? But I'm not an unreasonable person. I'm not uninterested. I'm not uninformed about history. I know the implications of these things. I have arrived where I've arrived from a different route. I've arrived there through academic study. I know why racism happens.
We live racism. We don't have to study it to understand it. We live it.
And the issue is you think scientific proof everything. What about all the racist scientific theories
they have
about
black people?
Explain that. No.
It is not your
place. You're going to answer.
He replied that he did not think he was wrong in his actions, which upset both students of color and white students. The students chanted and continued to try to make their feelings known to Weinstein, but he was refusing to listen and instead attempted multiple times to take over the discourse and make the students listen to him.
I need to read a book to understand racism and oppression.
You do.
Are any of you willing to have a discussion?
We're trying to right now.
During all of this, some threat students were surrounding him and verbally attacking the group of protesters.
I listen to you, and you listen to me.
We don't care what terms you want to speak on. This is not about you.
I'm talking
we are not speaking
all about
terms
him.
On terms of white privilege. This is not a discussion. You have lost that one.
I am talking about terms that serve the truth. Those are the top.
After 20 to 25 minutes, the students exit the building while chanting and make their way down the walkways of the Seminar 2 building on the second floor. At this point, the students were attempting to debrief and discuss what just occurred when Officer Timothy Odell arrived and attempted to push through the crowd of white students protecting the people of color and those with disabilities.
Oh,
block me, out of my way.
Out of my way now.
The police chief Stacy Brown also arrived and attempted to assist Odell with accosting people of color. After some time of nonviolent dialogue, the students began to file down the stairs towards the Red Square. By the time most of the group arrived at Red Square, both state troopers and Olympia police showed up and began to threaten students with mace and arrest.
Do you care about your students? Do you care about our safety?
Do you?
Very much.
Hmm. Okay, so why are the police trying to like fucking mace us and shit for us telling Brent that he needs to apologize?
Because they mace you.
Students, fearful for their lives, began retreating towards the library and ultimately ended up at the Trans and Queer Center Unity Lounge trying to stay safe. The white students were then delegated to spread out throughout the library floor and watch for police potentially surrounding the building. The white students did see police around the building, but as of this point, most of them have retreated. This is all that the students know to have happened at this time. The students are trying their best to get their voice, their message across in a peaceful manner, but only are being met with backlash and excessive police force. This is the active and only true narrative of today's events. Stay tuned. Hashtag expose evergreen.
My point to students for years and years and years has been, you have to be careful because evolution itself has set you up to prefer people who are more closely related to you than people who are more distantly related to you. And that means we all have latent racism waiting to emerge if we do not confront it ourselves. That has been my message to our students. Okay? So that message is about ending racism permanently. It is about recognizing that your genes want something. What I say to my students is, what your genes want cannot be defended. Right? It is indefensible, and therefore it has to be confronted. That is the central message of this program. That is the central message of the program I taught in fall and winter. It was my central message last year as well. I have offered, and what I keep being told is, no, we know what you believe. It is this, it is vile, and it is unacceptable. And that's not true. You don't know what I believe. So, in any case, if there is interest in a discussion, I'm ready. I don't really need to be shouted out.
Yeah, I understand that, but also these students are angry
and their anger is valid. And I would, here's my email, I will organize with them and schedule. So let me know when you're free to have that discussion and we will figure something out with the students.
Fair enough.